Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Chloe. I'm on the video team over at Jazz at Lincoln Center. In just a minute, we're going to join Jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra saxophonist Ted Nash for part one of his masterclass celebrating Wayne Shorter. In today's session, Ted will be in conversation with Seton Hawkins of Jazz at Lincoln Center. They'll focus on Wayne's work as a sideman and explore his time with Art Blakey and Miles Davis. After the lesson, Ted and Seton will answer questions from you all, and I'll jump back in before we get into that to explain how to ask a question. For now, if you want to shoot me a chat, if you have something in the meantime, go ahead and do that. We hope you all enjoy this masterclass with Ted Nash and Seton Hawkins. Go ahead, Ted.
What's up, everybody? Hey. Seton.
Hey. So, everybody, I want to give you a real quick background on why we're here, apart from the obvious, because Wayne Shorter is a legend. What you are about to be checking out is the first of a two-part class. The next one will be same time next week. This was originally going to be a class taught by Ted Nash for Swing University at Jazz at Lincoln Center in New York. Ooh. And then, I don't know, for some reason, everyone just stayed home in March, April, May. So we figured...
Lazy bums.
I know, man. So let's gather now and let's celebrate the great Wayne Shorter. Now, to start it off, Ted, when we were talking about this class, you had an idea that I think is a really great way to roll. Today, we are looking at Wayne Shorter as a sideman. And then next week, Wayne Shorter is a band leader. Let's just start off with maybe the obvious question, your thoughts on splitting it that way and what we gain in terms of understanding his writing or his playing by doing that.
The thing with Wayne, I mean, he was such a genius and such an important contributor to the jazz art form. There were so many different ways that we could have broken this down. I was thinking also we could have talked about Wayne, the improviser, versus Wayne, the composer. There's so many ways to break things down. We can't do it all at once. So I just feel that if we think about Wayne and how he first came on the scene, he was a sideman. He was in Blakey's band. He was in Miles' band. He did records with Freddie Hubbard and Lee Morgan. And I think of his early career as being where he was really trying to find his own voice, his own personality in the music. And you could hear extremely strong influence from John Coltrane in his early years. And I think that that was apparent until he got into Miles's band. And I think that's where he really started to find his own voice. And so I don't know, I just thought that was a really natural way for us to break down the classes, and we can explore, because he is such an incredible leader. He had over 20 records of his own, and his compositions are, I think he changed the course of jazz composition and the way people compose music to create their own environment, their own, environment for them to play, not just, you know, ditties over blues or I Got Rhythm, but he was a composer. He's considered one of the greatest jazz composers, living jazz composers, certainly in jazz. But I also think it's important for us to kind of address his mythology. And Seton, you can just jump in or interrupt me because I'll just talk forever. But I mean, he was born in the 30s in Newark, New Jersey. And I think about, we think of him as a musician and a saxophonist and composer, but he was an artist. He was a fine artist. That was his first love. In his early teen years, he wanted to paint. He wanted to draw. He also loved the theater. He loved theater. He loved movies. He can talk about movies forever. He can just go on about names and books, and he talks about the books. I've read interviews with him where he just talks about theater. He used to play hooky. He used to ditch school to go to the theater. Mm-hmm. And they were like, "Why? What are you doing?" And he also said, well, the live bands were playing at the theater. So his mythology was very, very important in shaping him as a person. And his music reflects so much of those early interests and how he grew up.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So in terms of picking his work as a sideman, I was really curious what tracks you were going to select, because even if you pick the window of the early 60s, and I mean, and he even predates that. He's doing fabulous work with Wynton Kelly in what, 57? Even picking that four-year window in the early 1960s, there is an insane amount of material. But I want to start with the first one you picked, because you picked a truly weirdo one, and I love it. So we need to do a little backstory on this. There are sessions that are legendary from the 1950s of Miles Davis and Gil Evans recording for Columbia Records, Miles Ahead, Sketches of Spain, and Porgy and Bess, those three classics of what we call third string music. But we forget that there's a fourth set of sessions that take place in the early 60s that lead to a sort of an aborted album called Quiet Nights. And during those sessions, they work as arrangers and musicians on another set of dates with a cool jazz pianist and vocalist named Bob Duro. And they record a Christmas song, Blue Christmas. And this is important because while Wayne Shorter does not join Miles until right on the cusp of 1965, Wayne is on this date.
I know.
So I'm curious about pulling out this very cool, weird obscurity, your thoughts on it.
Well, because he didn't join Miles until after that. But, Miles was checking him out. Miles knew what was happening. Miles was checking out Blakey. He was checking out. Miles had, besides being a genius and being an incredibly talented improviser, he had also a brilliant ability to find young musicians. And Wayne Shorter was probably on his radar at this point. And I think the record, you probably know more about the record itself, Seton, but I know that Bob Duro sings on it. And I think that there was some friction about that with Miles. But when I first heard this, I didn't have the record in front of me, but I listened to it somewhere and I said, oh, that's cool. Coltrane, nice. I thought it was Coltrane.
Yeah.
And I think that's what's so interesting about Wayne is that so many people do imitate other people. I mean, people, I did a class once called Living in the Shadow where I chose artists who were so influenced by people and couldn't quite get out of it and their careers suffered as a result. Like Paul Kinichette is an example, who sounded like Lester Young, and they called him the Vice Prez, which is kind of rough. But when you listen to Wayne, and you listen to this track of Blue Xmas, or Blue Christmas, it's Blue Xmas, I think.
Well, it's written as Blue Xmas, but yeah, Blue Christmas.
Right, Blue Christmas. For me, he takes that first break, and it's absolutely John Coltrane. So I just think it's so interesting, because we're talking about, he's already been out there. He's already recorded several records since the late 50s, 59 with Blakey, et cetera. But this one for me just really shows an incredible example of someone who's so influenced by somebody, and how ironic that was the person that Miles was really checking out to be the next important saxophonist in his band, what they call the second great quintet, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, let's play this. What we'll do is we'll start partway into the track so we can get straight to Wayne's solo. All right, can everybody see the Spotify list? Just a thumbs up if you can see it. Perfect. I will also put the link to this into the chat window so y'all can check it out. We're gonna go about 50 seconds in and then we'll play it out.
Up, all the way up. It's a time when the greedy give a dime to the needy. Blue Christmas, all the paper is on the body rock. People trading gifts that matter not at all. What I call folly raw, bitter gall. Folly raw. Of hungry homeless children in your own backyards.
That's so great, man.
He really does sound like John Coltrane there. That is staggering.
So, yeah, even more so there than he did, I think, a year or two before that with the records he did with Blakey or with Freddie. he still had that strong influence, but that one, maybe, I'm just guessing that because Miles was there, he probably wanted to say, hey, I could be your next coach.
Well, so let's actually break this down. If you had to describe, say, so that we can create this contrast, if you had to describe the Coltrane sound versus how you might describe shorter sound on the tenor saxophone, how would you make that distinction?
Well, in that instance, the way he plays, he grabs onto some, some stylistic things that Train would do. He would lip up to certain notes. That's one thing. It's like that real expressive sort of blues bending of note up into a high note. That's something that was very Coltrane at that time. A lot of people didn't do. I mean, Benny Golson was dealing with it a little bit because he and Train were real close. So there was a school of people that had that sort of approach. We didn't have that before the arpeggio kind of playing of Coleman Hawkins and all that, where but that kind of way of expressing was very unique to Coltrane, I think. And then there's also kind of a way of running notes, the sheets of sound, they like to talk about it with Coltrane, where you just ran notes. Earlier in jazz, people didn't just run random passages or random scales. Everything was related to the time. So there was a point when people started to explore playing outside of the time. And I think the Train was really largely responsible for that. And Wayne would jump up on that as well. But you also hear in this track, Wayne's articulation started to really formulate his own style, which was like where he tongued extra hard. Like Train had a little bit more legato tongue. And he would tongue in the accents, sort of like what Bird would do or anybody that came before. There was a way that you used a light tongue to create accent, which also added to the time and syncopation. But then Wayne Shorter started to use more tongue, and you hear more accent in his notes, and you can hear it toward the end of that solo. And then you hear it even earlier on in some of the recordings that he makes, where he starts to really have this extra strong sort of articulation that later became a thing that so many people copied, who then sounded like Wayne. So it was sort of interesting.
Now you bring up the idea of Wayne sounding a little different on this track than he did on tracks from a year or two prior. So let's actually move to one of those. So the framing of this moment is, while that is 1962, during that period, Wayne is associated as one of the members of Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers. And he's there beginning about 1960. So you picked a track from that era, from the Night in Tunisia album from 1960. And specifically, this one highlights not only Wayne's talents as a player, but also as a composer. This is the song Sincerely Diana. So do you want to say anything about it, or should we dive right into it?
We could just dive right into it. I just think this might be the first, maybe I'm wrong, but this might be his first recording with Art Blakey, and it was live, right? This is a live.
I believe so, yeah. Well, let's throw this on. Now let me get us right up to his solo. I think I've got the timing right on this yet. Beginning until 2:10, perfect, okay.
And I do feel that he's at this point, it's like when you hear early Coltrane, well, you know the record, is it Tenor Conclave with the four tenors?
Mm-hmm.
With Mobley and Zoot Sims and all them, Alcone. And like Mobley was at the height of his, abilities and really finding out who he was, like as a musician. I thought Mobley kind of wiped everybody on that, because Train was still kind of struggling with trying to find how he could fit this weird, awkward style that he was trying to deal with into being something that's flowing and working. And I think with Shorter on this recording, and a couple of the recordings that I sent you, I think he's finding himself, but he's struggling a little bit to make it work. And that's what I find so interesting in these very early recordings, is that Wayne is so much trying to get away from Coltrane and find his own thing. And there's always going to be that period when it's not Coltrane and it's not you, it's somewhere in between.
Yeah. To say nothing of the fact that when he joins this band, he's following on the heels of Benny Golson in that band. So he's...
You know, Benny was like...
He's got a tough act to follow.
Oh my God.
Well, let's check this out. So this is Sincerely Diana. This is again, 1960. Oh, sorry, this one is not a live date. This is a Van Gelder date.
Okay, all right.
Yeah. Got that fresh in our minds. You hear the Coltrane element, but you do hear right away that much more articulated set of notes.
Right?
Yeah, well, in terms of what Wayne's doing there. But, right. You know, what are you hearing when you hear a solo like that?
I love listening to music by musicians who are in their formulative stages because you hear the connection through history. So I hear Coltrane, but I hear Coltrane's version of Dexter as well. Like there's a certain kind of absolute solidity in the time and pureness of ideas that Dexter had. Well, he didn't play a lot of fast stuff. He played stuff that was right in the middle. And I think Train used Dexter to get away from Byrd, right? It was sort of Train saying, I'm so influenced by Byrd and Sonny Rollins maybe, but you know, by Byrd early for sure, that he found Dexter as his sort of pathway to find his own thing. And you hear, when you hear Wayne Shorter on this, you also hear the Dexter through Train. I do anyway. But yes, so now you hear he's trying to explore, I don't even know if he's aware of what he's doing technically, it's just that's the way he hears. The thing is, if you hear something, you will develop whatever technique you need in order to play that. That's the thing. People are always like, well, how do you tongue and articulate? And as a teacher, I have a hard time answering a question like that because I feel like anybody will just find the way to express something if they have something to express. If they're hearing and feeling something, they will find the technique to do it. I also think that he's exploring. He's not afraid to try to, he's kind of stepping out there a little bit.
Yeah.
Saying, hey, you know, I'm not satisfied doing what I was doing. Let me try to find some new areas. And you can hear in those moments at times when he struggles a little bit, but that's the beauty. That's what's engaging about the music is when you can relate to somebody who's making an exploration and you can be with them as they struggle through and try to find themselves. It's so engaging.
Yeah.
That's partly what I'm hearing when I hear him play. It's
absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, the next track that you've picked is a Freddie Hubbard track, or it's from a Freddie Hubbard album, although it is a Wayne Shorter composition, Marie Antoinette. And while the trumpet player we just heard is Lee Morgan, we do get Wayne and Freddie coming together in the Jazz Messengers beginning around 62. What's interesting as we cue up this track, that I love that you picked this one, is the question of Coltrane looms very large here, given that two-thirds of the Coltrane quartet are the rhythm sec, or two-thirds of the Coltrane quartet's rhythm section are on this date. McCoy is playing piano and Elvin's playing drums. So I'm curious about your thoughts. Anything you want to cue up before we play Marie Antoinette?
Well, and I also chose an original composition by Wayne. I feel that what identifies him so strongly, in addition to his unique way of playing, is his, are his compositions. Yeah. And even on that last track that we just listened to, it, you can hear the hard bop of Blakey in his composition, because he's coming out of Benny and the people that were before him in that band. But there's also something about the movement of the harmony that I find to be like Benny Golson's compositions are so brilliant. And there's what I love about them also is that they have such strong cadences and things that catch you off guard a little bit, but they're very cadence oriented. It's just, they shift a lot. Whereas with Wayne Shorter, he started to choose more arbitrary chords. In other words, like a major chord that might just move, mm-hmm. you know, or something. So it's not a 2-5-1, it's not a type of cadence. It's almost arbitrary movement. And he's starting to deal with that in those early compositions he did with Blakey.
Absolutely. You can,
I mean, absolutely hear that in all the compositions he does moving forward in his career, and stuff with Miles, obviously. So that's what I love. And about this too, there's a certain angular quality to the melody. It's not as linear necessarily as some of the melodies that people were playing before. And I don't know, I just really liked, I liked his imagination was incredible. You know, he was, I think he accessed a lot of imagery. He talked about that too. He wanted you to understand the imagery that he was feeling and thinking when he played. And I think his compositions are also very imaginative. I think in this case, with this song, it feels like that for me too. But it's still sort of an example of that early, in terms of improvising, that early trying to find his own sound.
So let's check this out. This is Marie Antoinette. So again, this is from the Freddie Hubbard album, Ready for Freddie. So this comes out in 1961. Freddie is obviously playing trumpet. You've got Wayne Shorter on tenor. And again, Coltrane is kind of here via McCoy Tyner on piano, Elvin Jones on drums, and then you've got Art Davis playing bass. Let me go ahead and do a screen share, and we will check this out. Thank you.
Amazing.
Unbelievable. Now, one question I have for you. When Wayne takes a solo, and this seems to be both on tenor and on soprano, there's a certain spaciousness to the way he'll think of lines. And there's a level of usage of silence that he brings in. And I'm curious about your thoughts on that particular approach.
Well, it's how everybody should be playing, is because the rests, the spaces are part of the music. A lot of times we forget about that. We just want to play a zillion notes. And that's not, to me, that's not that impressive. Someone could fill up the entire space, because Wayne could do that, Train could, anybody could do that. But Wayne seems to be maybe very intuitively aware of how important the space is in between the phrases. Also, when you leave space, you give a chance to the listener to engage with the phrase that you just played. So the longer, I mean, there's a natural time that follows a phrase. If a phrase is very long, sometimes you can be longer, because you have to allow the people, the listener, to absorb it, say, ah. And just when you feel like, and this is intuitive again, but you feel like it's time to start your next idea. A lot of times people who are younger, who are less advanced, will stack their ideas so much that we don't have a chance. We're still catching up trying to finish their what they just were thinking and feeling in their last idea, that we don't have a chance to process at all. So we start to be less engaged and push back a bit. And you can hear that with players. I mean, it's a great thing to listen to, not to just say, oh, this person's playing too many notes, but what is the effect that has on you on a listener, as a listener. You hear certain technical, like as a saxophone player, he's playing the middle D on the tenor, and you can play it with the regular fingering, which is everything down, or you can play it with the side D, which is like a high D without the octave key, and then you get a thinner kind of sound that goes off the C sharp kind of more smoothly if you want do like that. If you go da woo wah hoo, right? But also if you put the D and you put the side D at the same time, you open up that darker D, and yeah, it becomes kind of wild. And you can hear how tenor players have adopted that way of fingering the D, trained it a lot. It's just something that feels good. And you learn it and you start doing it. I do it all the time. It just feels really good to give that kind of like to that D. But I also love how when he finishes a phrase, oh, sometimes he has this little bend at the very end of the note. And that's a Dexter thing. And if you listen to the way he ends those notes, that's more Dexter than Train. And also his vibrato at the end of phrases is a little more Dexter than Train at times. I hadn't paid that much attention to the Dexter in his playing, actually, recently. So it's kind of interesting to see that.
Absolutely.
But you could see the angular quality of the melody of that piece. But we'll be a lot of jumps and stuff. It makes so much sense, but it's not the way the music was a few years before.
Well, and that's an interesting point. You know, we're in, at this point, sort of an era of very, very hard swinging, hard bop music. But you could see why someone like Miles Davis would be so attuned to what Wayne is doing during this time. You've got Miles trying to seek a way to sort of stretch beyond 32-bar, 16-bar forms, and you've got Wayne doing that in this laboratory of the jazz messengers. You could see why Miles might try to do some corporate poaching.
Well, it's interesting because Miles says, okay, this guy's talented. This guy has a vision. And I don't think it was Miles's responsibility to necessarily free him of the hard bop band that he was in. He was still had probably years to contribute to that band if he wanted to. But I think Miles saw the opportunity to say, my band would be better with him, and we'll go in a new place. And if you listen to, I know I sent you another track, Rain of Autumn Leaves.
Oh yeah.
What's so interesting is, and now I, when I was younger, when I was a teenager, one of my favorite records, was My Funny Valentine. It's also the other record is Four and More. So it's live at, was it Avery Fisher maybe? Or Carnegie? It was one of those, I think Avery Fisher. And George Coleman is on that. And George Coleman made a couple records with Miles. And George Coleman also was dealing with that Train a little bit, and Bird, but the Train sound. And so he was kind of like the next, after Train left, Miles was like, I gotta have somebody who plays like that.
Yeah.
So he chose George Coleman. But George, because now Miles had Tony and Herbie and Ron. So he switched everybody, but something was missing, and it was the right tenor player in the band. Yeah. So my understanding is that Tony Williams really didn't like George Coleman. That's I've read that. I've heard interviews where Tony says he felt that George was keeping the band mm-hmm. back in the late 50s in that style. And you can even hear the music that Miles, he continued to play that older music, the stuff that he's Milestones and all those kind of songs that he played in the 50s. Miles liked to repeat his songs over and over again. And I don't think it's because he was lazy or he was not imaginative. I think he always saw an opportunity for the song to continue to grow. And it was when those songs finally peaked in terms of what they could do with them, he moved on. But bringing Wayne Shorter into his band was the most genius thing.
Well, it's fabulous to bring that up, because if you think about that progression into Miles's band, the analogy that comes to mind weirdly is Goldilocks and the Three Bears, where you've got George Coleman, a fabulous tenor player who's much more in the hard bop tradition.
Right.
Then they switch over to Sam Rivers, an incredible player, but maybe stretching a bit too far out if we listen to the Miles and Tokyo sessions. And Wayne Shorter is just right, just enough to push away from those structures, but not too far out.
I like that. Not too cold, not too hot.
Yeah, just right.
But then who did Tony use on his first record on tenor? Sam Rivers.
You used Sam, that's right.
Yeah.
Well, so let's pivot back to Blakey, because you picked a fabulous, fabulous track and a very unusual one, the Paris Jam Session.
Oh, right.
And we have a guest appearance by none other than Bud Powell. And I love that you've got this multi-generational idea going on. You've got bebop pioneers, you've got hard bop inventors, you've got Wayne now stretching away, all coming together on this performance of Bouncing with Bud. Anything you want to say about it before we cue it up?
I'd never heard this before, and I found it actually just in preparing for this, because I was looking for some things that I didn't know. And I do love that when all these different things come together. I find that I just, as I listened to this, I was thinking, I put myself in Wayne's place. I took on Wayne a little bit in my own, and I was like, got really nervous. I was like, I'm playing with Art Blakey, I'm playing with Bud Powell, I'm playing with these amazing masters in a live at a club or whatever. And I got nervous listening to it, because I'm thinking, you've got to prove yourself. This is always you always hear about these things with Jackie McLean and Charlie Parker and all that, when they get their first opportunity to play and they're so nervous. And the alto player that's on this, he also, interesting to hear him play, because he's very derivative in some ways, and maybe that's why he didn't go on to be as famous as he could have been. Great player. But anyway, I kind of identified with Wayne's, like, being in a situation where he had to step up, and I think he struggled on this a little bit, but it's so unique and it's so personal, and I really love it.
So let's check it out. So this is 1961, it's in Paris. Bud Powell sitting in, Barney Weiland sitting in as well. It's otherwise Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers. And this is Bouncing with Bud.
Thank you.
that's killing though, you
good
know?
Lord.
So, and he's playing so much in that, man. And yeah. He leaves less space, something you pointed out in the other solo. I felt like he was leaving a little less space, but I just think he was excited. I think he had so much to express. He was like, he had idea after idea. Some of his harmonic choices are incredible. The tritone substitution he's using, some of the half step movements up into the next section. It's brilliant. His harmony has clearly really become strong. I mean, absolutely strong and powerful in this.
Absolutely. Well, you have to imagine from his perspective, Bud Powell's sitting in, he's now in the presence of one of the literal, you know, legends of this music.
Yeah.
I mean, so on that note, you referenced something, this idea that you might be terrified sitting in on a situation like that. That's happened in your own career, I'm sure. So how do you deal with a moment like that? What do you do on the bandstand in that moment?
I'll tell you a couple of stories. One, I was playing with the Mel Lewis Jazz Orchestra at the Village Vanguard. It was probably the early 80s, maybe 83, and I was in my very early 20s. And one of my heroes, Bob Berg, walked in. And he was someone who was a New York kind of post-Coltrane player that I had heard with Cedar Walton and Horace Silver. And so he walked in and sat at the bar and was just checking out the band. And then I had a solo and I played like probably five times as many notes as I needed to, because my idea was I wanted to impress Bob Berg. And I'm sure what I ended up doing was absolutely not that. Because you don't want to be trying to impress somebody. You want to try to engage them or move them in some kind of way. And I definitely didn't do that. So I totally failed. Another time, I played a lot with Louis Belson in quartet settings, quintet settings, and with his big band. And it was what kind of carried me over from being a teenager into an adult. And when I moved to New York, I still continued to work with him. So we did a workshop at some drum clinic thing in downtown. And so I show up, it's like Louis Belson quartet for drummers. I'm picturing all these students. Well, first of all, Mel Lewis walks in. And this is, I think, before I joined Mel's band, or I just started subbing in the band. It's probably like 81, maybe 82. And I'm probably 20 or 21, 20, you know, like that. And then Elvin Jones walks in. And he just checks out the band. And we play some swing tunes, Duke Ellington. We play Body and Soul and all that. I wasn't that self-conscious. I was just kind of like, whatever. But then Elvin came up to me, he goes, hey man, I like what you're dealing with, man. Listen, I'm playing Monday night at the Bottom Line. Why don't you come and sit in? I went nowhere near that club on Monday night. I was so scared. I did not go. I just sat home and cowered. And I never had the opportunity to play with Elvin again. Huh. So I always tell people, if you have an opportunity to do something, doesn't even have to be an incredible situation like that, anything. Sit in with somebody, engage with somebody, rather than just sit home. You will always have a memory, you will have an experience, you will get better. So I have to say I regret that, but it's interesting to be able to recount it as a lesson. But for me, I still get nervous when I play. I still get nervous, but my reasons for being nervous have changed a little bit from being the Bob Berg situation where I'm trying to impress somebody with. Now, sometimes I'm nervous that I'm not going to actually be in the moment. So I really want to just allow myself to be present at all times in the music. And that's a big deal for me. And that means listening, responding, and being relaxed. And so sometimes I worry about that not happening, because that's when the music for me doesn't work, when you're not engaged, and you're not present. So that's more what I get a little bit nervous about now. But I always remind myself that whatever it is I play, as long as I'm playing what I trust to be right in the moment, that's what it is. It you can't judge it. You can't say, why did I play that? Or why didn't I play this? Or that's what you played. That's what you played at that moment. And as long as you're in that space of trusting, then it will be okay. It may not be the greatest thing you ever played. I look at Sonny Rollins at the Live at the Vanguard, 57 or 58. When is it? 57, I think. He plays Sunny Moon for Two. You know, and he's, and then he just goes, whatever. He plays with that lick, and then he starts adding little things here and there. And but he, for five courses, he kind of just deals with that. I'm thinking it's brilliant because you have the rest of your life to play something else. You don't have to play everything you know right now. So that's a huge lesson for me. When I hear someone like Sonny Rollins at the height of his playing, being that sure of himself, that's the lesson. It's just like trusting.
Absolutely. So just with an eye to the time, I want to make sure we've got some time for Q&A.
Yeah.
But we would be criminally negligent if we don't play anything of Wayne Shorter in the second great quintet of Miles Davis. And you picked a really interesting track for this because you've picked the Live in Berlin date. So this is September of 1964. Wayne has just, you know, begun the process of joining this band. They haven't gone into the studio yet. You know, the ESP sessions are still about 4 months away. They're still focusing more on standards than on writing originals. And so this is a very interesting choice because you're getting this band congealing for the first time. Can you talk a bit about picking this particular one?
Again, I didn't really know. So I liked it because I wasn't familiar with it. But also, I think everybody knows so well Wayne and Miles's work after this and all the great records that they did together. And so what I like is that this for me feels like the continuation of George Coleman leaving and then Wayne coming in and sort of that transitional period of from his first great, Miles's first great quintet with Train or whatever, sextets, quintet with Cannonball and all that to the band that they had for several years with Wayne and Miles. And so here, you have Wayne coming in for the first time and dealing with the older set of songs. And I just thought that was interesting. Like, how is he going to deal with this? And I think for me, it's sort of like, I'm now with the band I want to be with. We haven't done everything that we're going to do yet, but now this is where I want to be. And his solo is just so open. And you can just tell the way he responds to the rhythm section. It's no longer, you know, like the kind of swing and hard bop thing. Now there's all the space. People are stopping. Tony Williams stops for a bit. You know, you can hear it shape. First of all, it starts a lot faster.
Yeah.
And it gets slower. And I was thinking, did they shift time? But it just, they found this groove. And by the time Wayne is playing, it's just, it becomes this open book of just space and time. And it's beautiful. But it is the earliest example, I think, of him with Miles.
Yeah, with the quintet. So let's put it on. We'll go partway in. We'll go about 4 minutes in so that we can get to Wayne's playing on it. Let me just quickly Spotify again.
Yeah.
And let me just fast forward to here.
Thank you.
I mean, it's pretty jaw-dropping. What it highlights is a comment Wayne made, though, that when he played with Blakey, as much as he loved it, the concerts to him always felt like it was a show. And he described seeing Miles perform with the almost second-rate quintet, and that it was an exploration, and he wanted to be a part of that. And you hear that in that recording, for sure.
It's like they let him out. They let him out of jail. And I mean, you can, if you listen to everybody's through line, it's so strong, even though at times they're not all agreeing. That's what I love about Miles' band, is a lot of times, you know, Herbie and Tony might be agreeing with something, and Ron's doing his own thing, and then one of the horn players is doing their own thing. And if you analyze it straight up and down, you can say, well, it's not working, but it works because everyone's got such a strong through line and they're so committed. How Herbie would get into that little rhythm thing and just stay in one little area, saying, go ahead, Wayne, you can deal with this for a while. You know, that's something you weren't getting before. Also, you can hear the way Wayne is thinking as a composer. Like, he starts creating, you can almost hear some of his compositions coming out of that solo. How he's repeating things and how he's thinking of very strong and sort of you know, like melodic kind of fragments that would be something that could very easily be a beautiful composition. So it's amazing.
Absolutely. Well, and this idea of he solos with a lot of space in mind is he is creating these beautiful, beautiful melodies in his solos for sure.
Yeah.
And it's interesting, you hear this track, it is this sort of almost preview of what you hear, say, in those Live at the Plug Nickel dates from a year later, of taking standards but kind of pulling them apart and rebuilding them. So we're at 4:53. I know we need to have some time for Q&A.
Let's do it.
But just a quick question in terms of concluding thoughts for this section and looking to next week, Wayne Shorter as a band leader, anything you want to close with before we go to Q&A?
Oh, no, I just think that how you compare how people work in different environments, like as a sideman versus as being a leader, it's always very interesting. Because there's so many people that were incredible sidemen or side people who never broke out and became leaders. You think of people like Johnny Hodges or Paul Gonzalez, people like Reduke, or even Nat Adderley, who was a leader kind of, but I mean, he really was thought of in this role of a sideman. How do you break out? And I think because of Wayne's incredible creativity and his artistry and just being such a genius, it was easy for him to create his own space in the music with his compositions. And if we take this band and then we get into the 70s, you'll see the influences that he has from the rock rhythms, synthesizers, all sorts of things that came out in the 70s with Joe Zawinul, Weather Report, and all of that. But he also, he played with Joni Mitchell. He played with Steely Dan. I mean, he played with artists that he recognized as being important, but weren't necessarily jazz musicians or jazz bands. And I think that's pretty incredible because he always kept a really strong integrity in his relationships in those other kinds of music too. Like, he didn't just try to sell out. It was never about selling out, which some people did. For him, it wasn't. It naturally became more accessible in some ways because of the rhythms and maybe the purity of the harmony. But that's it was a natural development, not something that he just decided to do. He was searching, but he wasn't trying to sell out. There was that time when, like, Red Clay or different records would come out. Everyone's trying to find their hit, the Sidewinder or whatever. And I don't think that was the case with him. I think his natural leadership as an artist, and he's an intense person. I've only gotten to know him a little bit, but he's different. He's a different cat.
Well, I'm very excited about this because I feel like if we had a tenor player and composer who had only done the things we cover today, we'd still be talking about what an incredible musician this was. We have an entire week of the things he goes on to do. So this is incredible.
Yeah.
So what I figure, why don't we move it over to Q&A now? And then I have, by the way, for everyone, I've put the playlist into the chat window on Zoom and on Facebook. Hi, Facebook. And we'll do the same for next week. But Chloe, over to you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, guys. For anyone that's just joining us, this is a masterclass by Ted Nash with Seton Hawkins from Jazz Lincoln Center, brought to you by Jazz Lincoln Center in New York City. As Seton mentioned, in just a minute, we're gonna take some questions from all of you. But before we get started, just wanted to take a moment to thank everybody for joining us, to thank our supporters who help us serve the global jazz community. We wouldn't be here without you. Your support means so much. So when we open it up to questions, we prefer to use the raise hand feature in Zoom so that we can call on you and have you ask your question directly. So to do this, please click the participants tab on the bottom of your Zoom window and then press the raise hand button. I see that someone has already done that. If you'd like to just message your question, I'll open up the chat so you can do that, or you can message me privately. If you raise your hand, please make sure that your full name appears as your username so that I can call you. Press rename next to your account name to do that. So when it's your turn to speak, I will unmute you and let you go. So our first question comes from Leo Steinride. Hey, Leo. Oh, I'll unmute you, Leo. There you are.
You hear me?
Hello. Yes.
Hi. My question is, I'm sure you could teach a whole class about this, but Wayne Schroeder's compositions are really important in defining the sound of Miles' second quintet. And how can the composition shape the sound of the band before the band even plays in the stages where you're just writing the music? How can you make those kinds of changes before the band even plays a note?
Good question. And I know your name, by the way. I'm sorry we couldn't get together in person, but Leo was the winner of the Essentially Ellington Composition Contest just recently. So yeah, man, congratulations. Great piece of music. Well, I'd love to hear you answer that question, to be honest, because I like how you were dealing with composition in your piece. What is your feeling about that? I've got to unmute you.
Unmute yourself.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Oh man, I was not expecting this. that's just like something I've been thinking about. Like you were talking about space. I know Emmanuel Wilkins told me he tries to write with more space recently. So I've been trying to write with less notes, but I think there's like a really big difference in, I guess, Wayne's writing with the music he was writing in Art Blakey's band and then the music he was writing in Miles's band. Maybe it has to do with the chord qualities, but I think it's less of a technical question.
I think you're right. I think it's more about the trust and knowing the musicians that you have, which is partly how you frame the question. I think once you understand you have a certain quality of musician, I don't mean just quality because, you know, Art Blakey and everybody, incredible quality, but just the direction the music has a chance to go. And you could tell from Herbie and Ron and Tony, they're hungry, they're young, they wanna find something new, they wanna explore and let it happen. So when you know that those are the people you're working with, you can trust more to try some new things. And you also can hear things differently when you put it in the context of other musicians that you know how they play or imagine how they can play. I've done a lot of composing through an organization that we started called the Jazz Composers Collective, which we had for about 13 years and then disbanded just because we basically all got pretty busy. But Frank Kimbrough, Ben Allison, Ron Horton, Michael Blake, and me. And we challenged each other to compose all new music for a concert that we would be featured on. And I remember one time I was struggling and I was kind of in a crossroads for myself because I was my own version of coming from Blakey's band into Miles' band, my own version of that, where I wasn't happy anymore with kind of bebop or traditional chords and traditional forms. So I was trying to find some new paths and I wasn't feeling like it was happening very naturally. And they came over to rehearse and I pull out a couple things and I'm like, cool. And they were like based on improvisation. So I was recording improvisations and sort of shaping them. And that was fun. But then they were like, well, what else you got? I'm like, well, I got this. I'm not going to pull it out. They're like, well, why? Why not? I said, because it's not finished. And they said, well, pull it out. Let's just see what happens. So I had this real sketch. It was like things crossed out and changing time signatures and all that kind of stuff. And by the end of the rehearsal, we had made so much sense out of it that it ended up being on my record called Rhyme and Reason. It's called, that was Apollo 9. And a lot of that just because of the trust I had in them to help shape the vision that I wasn't even clear about at that point. And that's why it's so important to get with musicians that you can really relate to, because that helps you develop in all ways. I think that imagination, both being able to imagine where the piece is going, where the composition is going, being able to hear it even before you write it, and imagine people playing it, I think is very important. I mean, I think it's a great question, but you seem to have a great imagination, what I remember from your piece. I look forward to hearing more stuff from you.
Thank you. Thanks for answering my question too.
Yeah, sure, Leo. Great, man.
Thanks, Leo. Leo, we'll see you the first week of June for Essentially Ellington. Everyone, we're moving our annual high school jazz band competition to online, and we hope you can all join us for that. So our next question comes from Les. Hi, Les.
Hi, Les, guys.
There you are.
I unmuted. Great, great, great. Hiya, Ted.
Hey, man.
You're looking good, and thank you so much for all of your master classes. They are awesome. In my own personal growth as an improviser, lately I've been seeking new models for the kind of improvisation that Wayne has displayed amongst my other models, including Ted Nash. And listening even more detail from this show, it's almost incredible. By the way, on the Autumn Leaves version, you hear him doing almost a complete new composition, but yet in like one little four bar segment, he's saying, oh, by the way, I still know my bebop, just to let you guys know, which was incredible. But I see him as such a model for the kind of improvisational skills that the evolving player wants to sound like. So my question is there a point where we can't separate Wayne as a pure saxophone player from his entire package as an improviser / compositional player / composer? Where does he fit in the whole big picture of when you think of great saxophone players?
Well, he like Benny Golson, is an incredible saxophone player and an incredible composer. I think that he could have stood on either of those things by themselves. And when you listen to, you had such a great point in that Autumn Leaves version where he could play four bars of, well, bebop, but he could play also four bars of something that was so compositional. You could hear his brain thinking and turning and churning compositionally. And that's what I love about this period of him, is that he comes from being a developing improviser and a developing composer at the same time. A lot of people, sometimes they get their chops together as improvisers and later they're like, okay, now I'm gonna start composing some music. But his was all at the same time. And he, I think he changed the direction of jazz composition. I really do think he was extremely responsible for a new way of composing. You look at people like Joe Henderson and people like that who came like with Inner Urge and those kind of things, where you have, I mentioned before, sort of arbitrary movement and then cadence. Like what Wayne would do, would he would find these jumps and these interesting ways of moving the harmony around and then give you that little bit of 5-to-1 kind of, you know, something. I think that when he joined Miles, now he's like hearing, he's here, like as Leo asked, he's hearing those musicians. And I think you never set out to say, well, how am I going to find my style? Like people sometimes ask me that. How do I just develop my own sound, man? I got to find my own sound. And if you sit there and work on your own sound, like I'm going to find my own style, it's probably not going to be genuine. It's probably not going to be honest. So people who, like Wayne, Miles, their strong personality comes out of their dedication to first sounding like other people and listening to a lot of different music. Then they just keep working and they're not satisfied. So it happens naturally. And I think for everybody who is that same type of personality, listening to everybody, figuring everything out, not being satisfied, wanting to find something. He had such an imagination. He thought of imagery and movies and films and theater and all that we talked about earlier came out in his playing. I've heard you play some great stuff, man. You know, you got an imagination. Yeah, man.
Thank you, Les.
Thank you. Thank you, Ted. Good to see you.
Great to see you, man.
All right, awesome. Our next question comes from Marcy Bell. Hi, Marcy.
Hi there. Okay, you've unmuted me. Thank you for a wonderful class. I'm thinking of Wayne Shorter playing the saxophone in his later life, and I'm wondering, did he play the saxophone, soprano saxophone, at this stage of his development?
Back then, or are you talking about?
Yeah, back then. The period you covered today.
I haven't heard any soprano, in this period that we just dealt with, I didn't hear any soprano. I mean, he might have been playing it. I mean, Coltrane played it. Seton, you probably know the answer to that.
Yeah, he doesn't really show up on soprano until about 1969. So on Supernova and on In a Silent Way, you hear him starting to break out the soprano, and then it will become a mainstay for him going into the 70s. But in this portion of his career, he is all tenor all the time.
And it's interesting because once he found the voice on soprano, he embraced that in a way, like Dave Lieben did. Whereas Train, he kind of messed with it, but it didn't ever feel quite like his voice. But Wayne somehow made that such a strong. I love him on soprano. I mean, I just think he has I'm both tenor and soprano. He has incredible individuality. And I think what's interesting about people who get older as they play, because Wayne is what, 80? Eight? How old is he?
Well, he's born in 1939, but I'm not a math major, so 80.
Oh, I thought he was born in 33.
I think it's 39.
What? Yeah. Anyway, he's in his late 80s somewhere. I know we played with him when he was 81, 82, I think.
33, yeah. So he's 86. Sorry about that.
86, 87. So incredible that, first of all, he can still play with the amount of artistry that he plays with now. But sometimes people will become a caricature of themselves. Like, and I don't mean necessarily in a bad way, but someone like Phil Woods, who you listen to him go by the time the 1980s or 1990s came around, or even the 70s, I mean, he had such a strong sound and such a strong way of playing that he kind of stayed in this one sphere. And Wayne, he's developed a real strong sound with that articulation, the way he plays with space, and the way he plays a lot of chromaticism. That became a signature thing of him, how he would play chromatics and he would tongue them and all that. And that's it's almost like a caricature of something that he was dealing with early on, but not in a negative way, not in a sense that he's just playing his licks. It's like his sound became very specific. He's just that kind of artist. It's always interesting to think about where people like Train, Train had maybe good solid 12 years of development that we know on record, but maybe more about, Clifford Brown and Bird and people like that. What would they have done, you know, in their 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s? I always think about that. But Wayne shows us how it is done. You just stay true to yourself. Wayne was absolutely true to himself. Amazing. So inspiring. Yeah. Do you like his soprano playing? Do you have a preference, Marcy?
I like a soprano. He seems a little different on the soprano than the tenor. I prefer the tenor. Just I like that full sound that the tenor gets.
It's interesting because a tenor is a more human voice range, I think, especially a masculine human voice range. It feels more natural for me. But the soprano, just, it's so high. I mean, it's got its own character. And I think that with Train, he had that real nasal kind of quality of the sound. Bechet had his own thing, which was amazing. I think Wayne made the soprano sax something that no one else had made it before. He was responsible, I think, for a lot of people playing soprano sax, for sure.
Thanks for your question, Marcy.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, we have time to get to these last two questions. But before we do, I just want to take a moment to say and to ask you guys to please join us again. We'll be hosting free live events every day throughout the coming weeks, including more masterclasses, conversations with members of the Jazz Lincoln Center Orchestra, question and answer sessions with Wynton Marsalis. Like tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, we have Skane's Domain, which is a Wynton's question and answer web show, if you will. Our next masterclass will be this Wednesday. That will be with trumpeter Kenny Rampton. Kenny will be celebrating his former band leader, Ray Charles. He'll share stories from playing with Ray and play some of his favorite recordings. That'll be this Wednesday, May 13th, right here on Zoom and also on Facebook. Then Friday, we'll enjoy a masterclass from trombonist Chris Crenshaw. The next Monday, Ted will be back to bring us part two of his Wayne Shorter masterclass. For a full list of those upcoming events and concerts, please check us out, Jazz Lincoln Center at jazz.org. That's our brand new online hub, jazz.org. And thank you again for everyone for being a part of this community. If it's within your means, please consider making a donation. Jazz Lincoln Center is a nonprofit organization, as many of you know, and we continue to be committed to entertaining, enriching, and expanding a global community for jazz. We're so, so grateful for contributions of any amount and to our supporters and donors. We cannot thank you enough. Someone asked what's on the Skane's Domain is tonight, which is Wynton's question and answer show. That's 9 p.m. You can access the Zoom link from our website, jazz.org. You can scroll down and it'll bring you right to a calendar, which has a link for you. You can also watch on Facebook Live. So let's get to our final questions. This next one comes from Darian. Hi, Darian. I'm trying to unmute you, Darian. There you are.
Hello. Yes, back to what you said about missing the opportunity to sit in at a gig. What would you say to a young jazz musician that's starting to develop a career in this and trying to get work done?
Do you mean like you?
Yes.
Well, the thing is to be as present as you can. It's hard, and of course right now is not a good time, but basically there are jam sessions, there are opportunities to sit in and play. What's important is how you deal with those situations, because there's a bazillion people who want to sit in and go to jam sessions and do all of that. It's how you come with humility, how you come with a certain sort of like, I'm here to learn from you, right? You when you approach people, you say, and it should be genuine. So it's the people that you go to hear that you really like, and you say, look, I've been checking you out. You're so inspiring. Could we just talk sometime? Could I get a lesson? If there's any possibility of me sitting in, you know, but you come with humility and you come with your business card, but a willingness to accept whatever they give you. And I did that when I first moved to New York. It was 1978, I was 18. So I was one of the young musicians trying to come on the scene and do all that. And I used to go to jam sessions and play way too long and do all the things you're not supposed to do. I remember two of Blakey's sidemen were playing a gig at Sweet Basil, it was called. And it was Bobby Watson and the tenor player that was playing with him at the time. And I went up and I was like, hey man, could I sit in? And they were like, hell no, I don't know who you are, get out of here. So it was like, okay, my approach wasn't that good. But I changed. I realized you can't just be smug. You can't think like you're the end all, you know, the next thing. You just have to come and find the people that who could inspire you, mentor you in some kind of a way. And you'll find those experiences. They'll happen. They'll happen. But go to jam sessions. Go to things. Go check out music. Go talk to people. Go to rehearsals. Tell somebody you're happy to go and rehearse for free, just to because you want to be involved and you want to meet people, and like that. That's a good thing to do. I mean, right now, you know, just get to be heard by as many people as possible. Mm-hmm. It will happen. Yeah.
Thank you.
You can play, and you're sincere. You know, sincerity is one of the most important things. And if you can fake that, you've got it made. All right, it's a joke.
Thanks a lot, Darian. Good luck.
Thank you.
All right. Our final question comes from Brad. Hi, Brad.
How you doing? Am I on?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, so first of all, thank you. These classes, these Zoom classes are great. They're excellent. I'm getting a lot out of them. And I really look forward to next Monday because I know more about Wayne Shorter from Weather Report. Weather Report was probably my first exposure to jazz and Mysterious Traveler. I think I wore a groove in that record because I was always trying to drum to it. But secondly, ironically, right before I clicked on this class, I was listening to Speak No Evil. And I was sure you guys were going to click on one of those tracks because that's some awesome stuff. Mm. Maybe you could talk a little bit more about that period when you did that.
I mean, again, I wasn't really trying to avoid, but I just thought that some of the stuff that everybody knows so well wouldn't have been that interesting. And I was more kind of interested in talking about early Wayne with this. But it's interesting what you said about Weather Report, because so many people got turned on to music because of Chick Corea and Weather Report and some of the more fusion-oriented bands in the 70s, because I think it was very accessible, but it didn't lack integrity musically. So I know Frank Kimbrough, a piano player that I've been playing with for over 30 years. The first time he heard jazz was Chick Corea's Light as a Feather record, I think it was. And man, anything that pulls you in, even like for me as a kid, like listening to Blood, Sweat, and Tears, because I dug the horns, and they played solos and all that. It gets you in there. It attracts people like you who are interested in deeper things. That's what I love about that. So I'm not gonna talk too much about more about Wayne, but except for the next week, we will get into some of his 70s stuff. I think that's going to be an incredible thing to explore. I love a lot of those records that just have something else, man. It's not just like fusion music. It's something deeper than just that. It's something you can't even, I don't know, label in some kind of way. So.
Yeah, right.
Thank you, Brad.
Thanks.
Yeah, man. See you next week. Thank you for coming. Yeah.
All right, everyone. And just because I've become a pro at plugging things on Zoom, if you are a Wayne Shorter fan and you are a Jazz Lincoln Center fan, please make sure to check out our Blue Engines record, The Music of Wayne Shorter with the Jazz Lincoln Center Orchestra. It is one of my personal favorites since
working. Yeah, check that out. It's Wayne.
It's amazing.
This one. Oh, here, let me turn off my
battery. Yeah. It's Asim will share the link. Great. But it's a very special record and Wayne sounds amazing on it. So everyone, thank you so much for joining us. We have to end it now, but we will be back next week with Ted, and we'll be back Wednesday with Kenny Rampton for his class. In the meantime, feel free to check us out on social media. That's Jazz Lincoln Center on Facebook and jazz.org, spelled out D-O-T, on Instagram and Twitter. And we'll see you soon. And thank you so much, Ted and Seton, for your class today.
Thanks.
I'll turn over to Ted for any final words, and then we'll let you go.
What did you say?
I'll turn it over to you for any final words before we let everyone go.
Well, you know, this is an incredible time. We're all going through stuff and we're all suffering in different ways. I know Jazz Lincoln Center when Chloe mentioned, you know, a donation of any kind, I mean, $5, $10, if you can spare it, would be really, really important. We want to engage with more people. We're constantly, like right now, Jazz Lincoln Center, all the sidemen in the orchestra, I should say side people, we got and Camille Thurman, everybody, we're recording music, we're sending it in, we're doing education, we're very involved. We're not, you know, we're all working at a reduced rate of salary. We're not. So what I'm just saying is that we're trying to keep producing stuff that is engaging, is creative and all of that. And Jazz Lincoln Center has been incredible through this time. And I just want to say that I can't believe how supportive they have been, the band and everything like that. If anyone has the ability to make a donation to Jazz Lincoln Center, it would be really incredible. So I don't know, I shouldn't quite say all that, but I just—
No, it's perfect. Perfect. All right, everyone, thank you so much. We'll see you next time. Take care.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.